So for the final, what I plan on doing is taking questions from the homework and from the test, primarily from the test. There'll be questions there. The final's gonna be how you have it made up. Five questions. So today and Thursday, I'm gonna go over tests 1, 2, 3, and 4. We're gonna look at problems. So problem number 11. I provided a lot of hints throughout this test. One of the ones that I provided was the equations for the transformer. Does anybody know if Cassie's going to be here today?
She's doing something in the graduation ceremony or something.
Okay. So what we have is we have like a typical distribution transformer mounted on a pole. And this is one of the things that Nick talked about when he presented. Most of the people got this right. I think there's only like maybe one person that got this wrong, but I'm just going to go over all these just to be thorough. So basically, it's tapped in the middle here, and because of that, the voltage V2 is actually 120 plus 120, so it's 240 volts on the secondary. 200 on the primary. And this designation N1 to N2 is the turns ratio. That's the number of turns on the primary side to the number of turns on the secondary side. And the number of turns, the more turns you have on one side, basically you'll have more turns on this side giving you a higher voltage, you'll have less turns on this side giving you a lower voltage. That's the way transformers work. And you can use the number of turns to get the corresponding voltage. So basically, if you know this voltage and you know this voltage, you can get the turns ratio. So 7200. Turn ratio is 30. This is V1 equals 7200. V2 equals 240. And then I want given as 10 amps. I think Nick had 3.5 in his problem. And the only thing you really had to solve was I2. And that equation was given too. It's basically the conservation of power equation. Power that goes into one side of the transformer must equal the power that goes into the other side of the transformer minus the losses. You'll have some losses in the transformer, but power in must equal power out. And that's what this is. I times V equals P. So the power on the primary side equals the power on the secondary side. So you know everything, but you don't know I2. So rearrange this equation, solve for I2. I2 equals like I said, most people got this one right. Didn't have too many problems with that. The next one, I'd say probably half the people got this one right. These markers. So for this one, ZAB, it was the equivalent impedance across this. If you connected some load to this, what would be the equivalent impedance to it? Is there any questions on this, by the way? This one's pretty straightforward. Any questions on that? This one, the one thing that will get you on this one is leaving off the I's when you put things in parallel, and then the negative on the capacitor can get you to. I think some people took that off. But anyway, I gave you, and Jeff pointed this out, I had the units wrong, but omega equals 377 radians per second. So omega will be, always be given as radians per second, and then the frequency equals 2 pi f, where f will be given in hertz. So omega was given, so you have to calculate xl and xc, and we know the equations for those. put this next one here, just so I can stay in the middle. So for this one, it was use the node voltage method to find V0 in the circuit. Some people did the mesh analysis for this, and I had to take off points for that because this problem was exponentially easier using the mesh analysis. It was meant to be used with the node voltage method, and that was a lot harder because the complex numbers are in the denominator. So if you use the mesh analysis, I had to take points off of it, even if you got the right answer. I think everybody in here is really, really good at mesh analysis. And it seemed like when I was in school like that, I was really good at mesh analysis too. The node voltage analysis seems like people are still struggling with that, so that's why I want to keep asking those questions. Not to punish you guys, but just so you guys can get better at it. Solve this problem is, I actually wrote two node voltage equations, one here and one here. But you didn't have to do that. You actually only needed to write one right here, and then you could have used voltage division to calculate the voltage across the 30 ohm resistor, which is, if you go to the problem 9.54 in the book, it does it like that, which is where I got this problem from, and I just changed the numbers. But I thought it was easier for me to go ahead and write two equations, and then my calculator would automatically do that for me, and it kind of saved me a step, even though I had to write additional equations. So, personal preference. Okay, so when we're writing the known voltage equations for this, it's important to remember, since this is kind of a review for the final, that the node voltage, if you remember, is writing the KCL, the currents around the node, right? And direction is very important. You know, for example, when I write this first equation, when I have this current here, and I write it as VA minus 240. If I write it like that, then the current, I'm assuming, is going in this direction. That's important because you have to stay consistent, otherwise it'll be wrong. And then when I write this one, I call it VA over 500. It's actually VA minus 0 divided by 500. But by doing that, the current is in this direction. Okay? Now, if I had a current source here, for example, and I plugged it in right there, the current would be going into the node. So then it would be a negative in the equation. I just wanted to review that with you. So the polarity of it is very important when you're writing the equations. So in this one, I only gave you voltage sources. But if I gave you a current source, and it's going into the node, and it's negative if you do it the way I write the equations. Okay. So I have VA minus 240. By the way, polarity marks are there. VA minus 0 divided by 500. Symbol, okay. By 30. actually just two for that one. And then we just put it in standard form, as we've done before in the past. Really, this is a pretty easy problem. The only complication is you've got complex numbers in it. I will caution you with complex numbers. If you put this in your calculator, and you don't put parentheses around this in your calculator, it'll basically bring this up to the numerator, and you'll be off by 90 degrees. So, practice it. That's the key. Calculator, you get VA equals 199.6. VB equals V0, which equals 138 minus 128 J. Do you guys want to take a second to put that in your calculator? Got any questions on that? It's only two equations. So that was, no problem, 13. Problem 14, which this one is this power triangle, three-phase power. Okay? This is what I want you to take from this class. So it says an electric load operates at 240 volts RMS. The load absorbs 20 kilowatts at 0.8 lagging power factor. Calculate the complex power and calculate the impedance of the load. Okay, so complex power is S. S equals P plus or minus Q, QJ. And I say plus or minus because it depends whether it's lagging or leading. If it's leading, it's going to be a plus or minus Q.
It's plus.
Yeah, so leading is is actually minus Q. Lagging is plus Q. Just think of it like, I guess you could write it down, but in the power system, we normally deal with lagging stuff. And so our most common thing that we see is P plus QJ. The only time we deal with the negative Q is if we have like a large cap bank on there. We have a leading power factor, but most of the time we have a lagging power factor. And so your plus Q is going to be your most common because the power system is usually lagging. It's not usually leading. I don't know if that helps you remember or not. But this S is a complex number. It has a magnitude and it has an angle. Okay, I had one person, he just put a magnitude, and that's only half the problem. Gotta get that angle too. So anyway, you're actually given, when it says the total load absorbs 20 kilowatts, kilowatts is the unit for P. So you're given P, P equals 20 kW. And it also gives you a hint, well maybe I took that out of there, but average power is another name for this, but you would know it just by units, kW. The units of Q is kVAR, and the units of S is kVA. Okay, so you know P, and there's a very simple equation. It's P divided by power factor equals the magnitude of S, which equals 25 kVA. So that's the magnitude. Now you have to find the angle. There's multiple ways to do this, but an easy way is to just use Pythagorean's theorem. Knowing that's a power triangle, a right triangle, you know S, you know P, now you have to calculate Q. So Q equals the square root of S squared minus P squared. Q equals 15 kVAR. So S equals 20 plus 15 kVA. With a J here, there's a J on the, so this is your P and this is your Q. I have a plus here because the problem said it was lagging. So that's part A. And if this is in rectangular form, if you wanted to do it in polar form, you would just simply do, how do you get the angle of this? You do the tangent inverse of y over x, which is 15 over 20, tangent inverse of 0.75, I would have also accepted this. So you could have put 25 at an angle of 37 degrees kVA. So this is the polar form, and this is the rectangular form. So I don't think I asked.
It is on the side. It says interesting to be rectangular.
Okay. Well, in that case, this is what I wanted, but if I didn't ask, then I would accept it as his fault. But you could have got this and then used your calculator to convert from polar to rectangular very easily as well. Now that you have S, I need to find Z. So this is part B. So Z equals B over I, Ohm's law. Except it's with impedance. And I know V was given in the problem, is 240 volts RMS. Since it's RMS, with power calculations, if it's given an RMS, there's nothing you need to do. You don't need to convert to peak. You don't need to divide by square root of 2. You don't need to multiply by square root of 2. We work everything in RMS values. So all you have to do is find I. I gave you a hint on the board. S equals B times I complex conjugate. I found S already, so all I have to do is take 20 plus 15J KVA divided by 240. It's in KVA, so it's 83.3 plus 62.5 J amps. Now it's the complex conjugate. That's what that asterisk symbol means. So I need to change this plus to minus, and I'm good. So that's I. So I know I and I know V, so I can calculate Z by just simply dividing 240 divided by this. So Z equals 240 divided by this. The solutions for this test, like I've done for all the tests, are posted on Blackboard. But don't just look at the solutions, practice it. That's just like in math class and physics class. If you're going to get through engineering, the key is to practice problems. I tell you that that's how I got through, unless you're like Einstein. You need to practice problems. So, work your test. Go through and work all the problems on your test multiple times. That's what I encourage you to do. So this is the answer for this for part B. I don't think anybody got this one right. I think some people are really close. Maybe somebody got it right, but I worked this one on one of the lectures, I think once or twice. Alright, so that was that one. Where are we on? Problem 15. Was there any questions on that one? Power factor, does that make sense? Is it pretty simple? Or I guess the key is to this one is getting familiar with the equations and having the equations on your sheet. And by the way, I'm going to allow 2 8.5 by 11 formula sheets for the final. This one was probably the easiest problem on the entire test. That's why it was only weighted as 5 points. But I don't think anybody got this one right. Question is, find ZL for max power transfer. Find the max power in watts. Okay. And it kind of, part A should have been very straightforward to you, that if you have a complex circuit, in order to get max power, the load has to be the complex conjugate of the Thevenin impedance here. So Z Thevenin equals 5K plus 6KJ ohms. So Z load equals Z theta complex conjugate, which equals 5K minus 6KJ ohms. A lot of people put plus there. I had a lot of other stuff going on. That's it. Just basically change that to a minus. That's all I wanted. Part B is the formula. So the trick with this problem, right, so it really wasn't a trick, is that the voltage here, this is your VThevenin. It's given in the problem. There's no more manipulation you have to do, because how do we find VThevenin across this? We open circuit and we find the voltage across this. Well, if this is open circuited, no current can flow through this. It's not a completed circuit. So the voltage across here is the voltage across here. So VThevenin equals 120 volts. And then there's the equation, it was Pmax 1/4, and it was given as RMS, so you use the RMS equation. Understand the confusion with this equation if you didn't catch that this was RMS, and if you're not real good with the VThevenin stuff, but other than that, is a pretty simple problem. I thought I just wanted to point out this. If this was just a resistive circuit, then ZTH equals Z load, but if it's a complex circuit, it equals a complex conjugate of it. And this is a very important, this is a practical problem for communication systems and electrical engineering. When you're communicating something, you don't want there to be large losses in your communication. You want to You want to basically communicate, and you want the signal to be received on the other end to be very strong. So you don't want any attenuation. So this concept is used in electrical engineering communications often. Number 16, so basically the last page was plotting the phasors, coming up with the phase rotation, getting the line-to-line voltages, and then doing the delta or the YY transform. Some people are confused on the rotation on this problem because I worked a problem and I did an opposite rotation where I did the clockwise rotation. But in a power system, we always do counterclockwise rotation. So for this one, this is VA. So basically VA, it passes through this GO, then VC is the next one. And then VB is the next one. So the rotation is, I would have accepted two things. I would have accepted negative rotation or ACB rotation. Swap two phases, it rotates backwards. We talked about that. This is A. So the line-to-line values, so you were given VA to neutral, VB to neutral, and VC to neutral. And so all you had to do is use your calculator and just subtract the phasors. So VAB would be VA minus VB, square root of 3, and angle negative 30. You could have graphically looked at this too. Basically, square root of 3, angle negative 30. So that would be on this problem, I specify I want them to be polar, and I think exact, so you get that square root of 3. Yeah. last one was just the YY transformer. I'm not gonna draw it up here. I'm not gonna answer or ask that on the final, but basically all of the neutrals are jumpered together, and then it's a mirror image of the primary onto the secondary side. So that was test number three. And I'm gonna go right into test number one, unless you guys got questions. Anybody have any question on this? No, what I was looking for is A, C, and E, or, and it was kind of off with rotation.
I just didn't know if that would be kind of the same as A, C, and E, the clockwise.
No, I was looking for like one of those two. Yes.
This should just jump right here and here to that neutral. And then this is, this one, this side is right here.
Okay.
So just copy it down on the minutes.
That's okay. Don't beat yourselves up. This is your first take at three-phase power. Some of this stuff's like, new to you guys, never seen it before, so. You guys did pretty well for never seeing it before. I will say that. And this stuff's like difficult, it's complex. Electrical engineering is a very difficult branch of engineering. And we've covered a lot of chapters in this class. I gave you guys a little bit more than what probably the average teacher would give you. I think the average teacher would maybe gave you 8, 9 chapters, and I gave you 12. So you can thank me or hate me. It's up to you, but for you, you probably like it. Questions on your test, I'll answer them if you want after class. Alright, so let's go with test number one. And I'm going to erase this. Assume everybody's got that down. So test number one. We're going to go back to mesh analysis. So the first problem was and we're changing gears a little bit. We've been talking about AC for the last few weeks, and we're going to go back and talk about DC, and then of course we're going to talk about AC some when we talk about we talked about test three. Maybe we won't talk about AC again, but you will see it on the final. I think today and probably the rest of today and Thursday will just be DC, but essentially the concepts, whether it's KCL, KVL, mesh, Norton, Thevenin, you know, on and on, you can use those same, whether you're using the frequency domain or the time domain. And that's kind of what this introductory class supposed to give you is kind of like a high-level review and just give you some tools, simple circuits. Obviously, the circuits in real life are quite a bit more complicated, but the tools that you learned in this class, you're going to have a really good handle on, for those of you that are doing electrical engineering program, or if you want to do like wiring in your house and things like that, I think this is a good class for something like that. So this problem, if you remember on test one, it was use the mesh current method to find the power delivered by the 120 volt source to the circuit and the power dissipated in the 8 ohm resistor. Does anybody want to try this? And you're summing the voltages around the loop. So, start with I1 and sum the voltages around this loop. So, I'm going to enter this voltage source, all right, negative 120. And because I'm working in this loop, everything's going to be I1 minus the other current. If I have complex numbers in a circuit, does anything change? If I have inductors and capacitors in there? Now, of course, if I give it to you in Henry's and farads, you need to convert it to ohms. Everything has to be in ohms in order to write the matrix. If you're writing a matrix, the units for that matrix all has to be the same. Then I1 equals I2 equals A, B is calculate the power on the 120 volt source, so calculate the power produced by this voltage source, and then calculate the power dissipated in this 8 ohm resistor. What about that 90 ohm resistor? What's that? Two currents flowing through this 90 ohm resistor. You have I3 and I2. So, what would be the equation for it? Well, either way, the power is going to be dissipated. Now whether you do a minus here or a plus here, it's going to give you, it might give you a minus or a plus, but the problem would just ask, what's the power? So it doesn't really matter whether you do I3 minus I2 or I2 minus I3. It's going to get you the same. One's going to get you a plus P and one's going to get you a minus P, but it's just asking what's the power dissipated, so you get a value either way. Yeah. So I'll go ahead and do that here. And I'll show that. So -1 watts. And then sorry, the square is there, so it doesn't matter, never mind. It doesn't matter whether you do I2 minus I3 or I3 minus I2. Okay. Since it's squared. That's the point I was trying to make, but it mathematically works out by itself anyway, so. Okay, the next question, this was like a really fun question on this test. I remember a lot of people writing node voltage equation in weird places. Thank you. this down? Anybody want me to keep it? This is just, these two lectures are just for you guys, for just for practice, so I mean, you don't have to, if you don't want to write everything down that I say, if you just want to practice with your calculator doing the simultaneous equations, if you want to just practice, you know, doing the things that you missed, just go ahead and do that. It's up to you. This review is for you. I just thought that since I already made the final, to me the best way for you guys to review, like I said, is to work these problems on the test. But you have the test and you have the solution, so you don't have to recopy them all if you don't want to. Does anybody remember this problem? That marks like chicken's head. Okay, so remember the concept of essential node. The essential node is if you have three branches connected to a node, then it's an essential node. And you cannot write a node voltage equation here because it basically is in between two resistors. This is actually one 10-ohm resistor split in two. And you just can't write a node voltage equation there, it won't work. So what you have to do instead, I'm sorry, there's a 2-ohm resistor here. Sorry about that. What you have to do instead is write two equations here and here. That is the way I recommend doing it. Jeff, do you want to try and get when you're done, do you want to try and get VX? You want to try that?
I don't know. Is it just?
Mark, you want to try it? it, but how'd you get one in?
One in?
When it branches off here, does it want to go through here and then see that?
Well, what are you doing? What are you doing there? You have 18 volts here, and you're calculating this. So, you have a voltage drop across a 6 ohm resistor. So in order to have a voltage drop across it, you must have current flowing through that 6 ohm resistor. So, you need to find the current flowing through the 6 ohm resistor. And how do you do that? Now you got it there 1 amp just because you remember that. You must have a really good memory.
I'll have a lot of things down written on the page there.
In order for current to flow, what must there be? So there must be a potential difference between two nodes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whether that's something to ground or line-to-line voltage. So you can think of it as like a line-to-line voltage. So in order to calculate the current that flows through that 6 ohm resistor, you can take VA minus VB divided by 10 ohms, and it'll give you the current that flows through that branch. That's how you do it. So go ahead and try it. If these are the same voltage, VA and VB are the same voltage, no current's going to flow. There has to be a voltage difference between them. Right? So there's ground here, and there's ground there. There's no voltage difference between these. Now current flows between this and this, but if you don't have sources here, there wouldn't be any current flowing between those two grounds. This is, all this is Ohm's law. It's voltage. If you follow the units, it'll set you straight, but it's VA minus VB divided by the equivalent impedance RA plus RB, which equals I. Now what happens if VB or VA is less voltage than VB? Then the current is going to be flowing, instead of flowing this way, it's going to be flowing that way. And instead of being a voltage drop, there's going to be a voltage addition. So this will be 18 volts minus 6 ohms, negative 1 amp, which will get you 22 volts. Okay. There's only 5 minutes left. I think I can do this problem real quick. Says find an arc equivalent circuit with respect to the terminals A, B for the circuit channel. There's multiple ways you can do this problem. The way I did it was I used voltage transformation. So I basically converted this into a voltage source. 10 times 12, 120 volts. Okay, to find the equivalent R, you short out the voltage source. So it basically makes 14 plus 10 in parallel with 6. So it's 24 in parallel with 6, which gets you 4.8 ohms. To get the ISC, you have to find the current that flows through this AB branch, ISC. To do that, what I did was I converted this back to a current source. And I basically put these all in a parallel branch, like so. Because they're all in series. Two resistors in parallel and they have the same value, the current that flows through it is going to be half of that, so it's 5 amps that flows through that, so the equivalent 5 amps, 4.8 ohms, and this is the Norton.
This will be the last time I record.
Okay. Because I got to return. watch it?
No, we had family members that was sick the past 2 months, so family government didn't get a chance to, but I understood Cassidy's